Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to worship. And we want to welcome those who are online worshiping with us. I'm Reverend Judy Barato, a retired United Methodist clergy, and here helping out today.
Go ahead.
Oh, okay. So today, it's a busy day today, lots of special things going on, but it's Human Relations Day, and you will find in the back of your the pew back an envelope for a special offering, and you'll hear more about this later. There are several ways that you can give. And also because of Human Relations Day, we are having some special treats in the Hospitality Center. So please make sure that after the service you stop by there. Several countries are represented and they look really good. And Soul Station this week, Wednesday at 5:30 or online. If you're here at 5:30, you can have dinner. Or if you can't make it here, you can be online. And Reverend Ron Bartlow will be the speaker this Wednesday as we connect the Barbie movie to our faith. So that ought to prove interesting.
If you're online, this is not a good time to switch over and examine the Barbie movie. Just wait. We're much more interesting. So there are lots of announcements on the back of your bulletin. Hopefully you grabbed one on your way in. The Blue Prairie Dogs are here on Sunday. That's one of our music groups, and we are very excited to find out what they do. So we invite you to come back this afternoon. Other announcements, as I said, are on the back of the bulletin. So this is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
That's from Psalm 118. We say that every time we gather in this space so that we remember whose we are and why we've come to worship. We welcome you.
You want to announce the video?
Do I have another one? I have a lot of announcements. We are going to see a video about our amazing meal packaging event that happened last week. There were lots of you helped, and we had help setting up, we had help packaging, we had people who stayed later to clean up, and you're going to hear this in the video, but we packed 17,000 meals. Yeah, and that is all. That's right. That's worth applause. And that is because of you. Even if you weren't there to work on it, and those of you at home or wherever you're watching from, even if you weren't there to package meals, you contributed, because that is one of the things that our missions committee allocates money for. So when you contribute to missions, amazing things happen. We're glad you're here.
Thank you. Good morning. My name is Sandy Heilman. Our call to worship echoes words from Psalm 139. Please stand in body or spirit as we join together. We've come to worship God,
long before
we were born, who knows us even better than we know ourselves, whose presence never leaves us, and whose love for us never ceases. This is our God.
Let's worship together.
Let us pray. Triune God of community, you gather us from far and near across time and place as your people. Thank you for forming us in your image and sending prophets to restore your beloved community. Pour out your spirit on us as we prepare our hearts to worship you. Strengthen our relationships with one another and with the fullness of humanity, so that we might live as your family. Open us to receive the good news of your steadfast love. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us sing our opening hymn, To God Be the Glory.
So hi there. I'm Pastor Judy, and I know that you're used to either Pastor Kim or Pastor Lynn being here, but I'm here visiting today to help you guys out. And I was wondering, we're going to be talking about neighbors. Neighbors. What is a neighbor?
Everybody.
Oh, excellent. He doesn't need to hear the sermon. Woohoo! Good for you. What were you going to say?
I was going to say, who are you living next to?
And that's how the word started. It's people that live around you, but in reality, in God's world, we are all neighbors. That's wonderful. Very good. The Good Samaritan, he said. So what do you do with neighbors, with the ones who live around you? What do you do with those folks? You care for them. How can we care for them?
Uh-huh. Beaten up by some robbers, and two people passed, but the third one helped him.
He took care of him. That's right. That's really good. And what other kinds of things do you do with your neighbors? The ones that, anybody? Deal? What do you do with your neighbor? You invite them over, maybe for holidays, or maybe just to have dinner sometime, right? Yeah, yeah. So, have you ever had anybody new move into your neighborhood or your class at school?
No?
No? Okay. But some of you have. Okay. Well, how do you get to know them?
Because you might get them in your class.
I know, but how do you get to know them better? I thought you were going to say something. Okay, go ahead. Well, okay, but how can you be that neighbor? What? Yeah, go ahead. Talking to them, right. We just talk to people and find out about them, and they find out about you, right? So in our story today, that's what Philip says to his friend Nathaniel. So whenever you've had somebody new and you invite them over, maybe you have a new toy or you have... you have old friends and you want the new friend to meet them, you say, come and see my new toy, or come and see my new friend, or come and see the friends that I have and be a friend with us. And that's what Philip said to Nathaniel in the Bible story that we're going to hear today. Philip wants him to meet Jesus, but Nathaniel's not sure that he wants to meet Jesus because he's from this different town that he doesn't really like. So Philip says to him, come and see. And that's what we have to do. We have to talk with people in order to get to know them, don't we? To know what they like and what they do and to let them know who we are. So that's what we need to remember to do to be a good neighbor. So let's pray, and please repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for giving us neighbors and friends. And the chance to meet new people. Help us to get to know them. Help us find out more about them. And for them to know about us. Help us make new friends. Amen. Thank you very much for being here. You can go back with your teachers.
Both of our scripture readings this morning center around God's call on our lives and our place in God's neighborhood. Our first reading from the Psalms grounds us in the love of God that is everywhere we go. Hear these words from Psalm 139, 1 through 12. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in behind and before and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light around me become night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light to you. Our gospel story introduces us to Nathanael and Philip, who meet Jesus for the first time. Listen to these words from John chapter 1, verses 43 through 51. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Hello again. Again, it's nice to be here with you. Would you pray with me, please? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I was ill for, about 4 weeks back in October, November of last year. I had no energy, no appetite. I was even afraid to drive to get to run my errands. My neighbors came to my rescue. They brought me soup. They brought me small meals. They even did my grocery shopping for me and chauffeured me to doctor's appointments and other places I had to go. It was a very humbling experience, I have to tell you. And I'm very grateful to them. And I'm grateful to those of you who had me in your prayers. But I guess it's not all that surprising that I had such help. I mean, we're a tight-knit group. We've been together a little over, it's coming up on 7 years. Actually, it's 7+ years. And we've been building relationships that whole time, talking with each other, inviting each other, being there for other people, being there for each other. And that was it's the same here at St. Mark's, because I've been here about that same amount of time. But I have a confession to make. In my neighborhood, my neighbors are pretty much like me, white, middle class, well-educated, and for the most part, politically similar. It's not so hard to warm up to folks when they're more like you, is it? But there are others in my HOA who didn't even know I was sick, and that's because we don't have a relationship. We haven't put in the time to get to know each other. Psalm 131 reminds me of the need of a close relationship with everyone, but especially with God. God is ready, willing, able to always be present. But it takes two parties to be in a relationship. You have to give and take. It can't be a one-way street. It can be no true relationship if you don't stay in touch with God, or you can't have a relationship with anybody if you're not talking with them. So have you taken the time with God? Have you done it with those who are near you? Have you done it with those who are different from you? We benefit from and have a huge responsibility in our relationship with God while we're living in this world. As children of God, we are siblings in Christ. And although siblings don't always get along, we're still family. But what about those who have different customs, different foods, different religions, different educational levels, different political opinions? Do you consider any of these your neighbors? Do you have more than a passing acquaintance with them, more than a work relationship? Are any of them folks you might call if you needed help or reach out to if they need help? How willing are you to learn from the other, someone not like you? My sister and her husband have hosted, probably 25 students over the last 40 years through AFS, American Field Service, and an exchange program all over the world. The organization has a number of different programs, but the one that they're most familiar with is the 10-month school year program. And what the program asks is that both the students and the host families to open up their world to new possibilities. The abilities of these students have varied. Their English level, their scholastic ability, their adaptability to our customs, difference in family dynamics from theirs to the one in the States. And those are only a few of the things that they have to get used to. The students hosted by my sister and her husband have come from all over the world, various countries in Western Europe, a couple in Eastern Europe, including the Ukraine. They had a student from Egypt, from which is obviously in Africa, an Arab country, and then from Asia, Sri Lanka and China. The students' economic status also varied. About half of them coming through with scholarships, and the other half had the means to pay full tuition, at least in that part of the United States where the program was in effect. These students and their hosts have experienced a lot of change. Changes in the sense of family, friends, and worldview. Their religion, or lack thereof, was not a factor. The bonds have remained strong. They still call my family mom, dad, grandma, whether it's been 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, or 25. In fact, the very first student they had came to visit last summer, and he was here in 87. So they are strong bonds. They came together to learn about each other and about different ways of life, and they have drawn their parts of the world closer together. I find today's gospel reading an interesting study of building community. First, Jesus asks Philip to follow him. Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, and so he was a friend of Peter and Andrew. So it's not a huge leap for Philip to go ahead and follow Jesus. But then Philip goes to try to get Nathanael. Now, Nathanael's a little more skeptical. And his response, and I love the way Sandy read that, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" When Nathanael asks that question, he is subtly making a claim that the people of Nazareth, including Jesus, are suspected of being no good. Philip doesn't correct him, he doesn't refute him. Instead, he tells Nathanael to come and see. He is suggesting that Nathanael needs to meet Jesus, to talk and listen to him before judging him or his character. Have you ever thought or said something like that to someone you didn't know? A hidden prejudice that popped up into your mind even if you didn't say anything? Persons whose clothing was a bit threadbare, who's wearing hijab or turban, those speaking in a foreign language or whose English is accented and not correct grammatically, maybe a little difficult to understand. Are you willing to come and see? Are you able to set aside any negative thoughts about someone until you learn something more about them? I was happy to see Pastor Kevin's message in last Friday's e-blast about Mr. Rogers' neighborhood. I recall a specific show in which his mailman, who was black, was talking to Mr. Rogers about the weather, which was very hot. Now, this was back in the day when public swimming pools were still pretty segregated. Mr. Rogers filled a kiddie pool with water, and then he and the mailman took off their shoes and socks and put their feet into the same water. Teaching by being a good example, a living example, not just telling it. And that's what we need to do. Jesus calls the disciples away from what they know of as home, from their towns and houses, and even from their communities and families. But he invites them to come and see a new family, a new way of being in community, the family of God. By accepting this invitation, the disciples experience an entirely new way of living. God promises to be present to, with, and in every human being, promises to be with us and love us, to guard us and guide us, regardless of what we may or may not be or do. Jesus tells us to perform that promise by feeding the hungry and sheltering the homeless, to trust that God's provision for some does not create a lack for others. That is what Human Relations Day is all about, recognizing the need for community and civil relationships with others through various programs that bring a variety of people together. The world would be a very different place for our children if we were able to see them the way Jesus saw people, no matter their circumstances or where they came from. Their very existence is vital. Peace is possible when God's children live in peace. Justice is realized when God's children seek justice on behalf of those who are downtrodden. We live in a world where peace is understood by the absence of disturbance. But in reality, true peace may require some disturbance. It may come only after the norms that rob people of justice are destabilized. Peace is when justice is accessible to every person, regardless of race, gender, sexual orientation, age, or self-identification. Peace is a human right that only comes when justice is realized. Love, peace, and justice are only possible if we actively pursue them for ourselves and our neighbors. That is the goal of the Church and Society Committee of the United Methodist Church, to make people aware of the injustices in our society and to motivate them to become involved in making necessary changes. We've been doing that through education, beginning with racial justice and advocacy and the recognition of special heritage months. We work with Rainbow Fellowship on LGBTQIA issues. We've begun looking at creation care and gun violence. And we're working with Pima County Interfaith on civic engagement of people who help change the systems that continue to promote injustice. It's time we turn that education into action. It's time to become involved in helping make some necessary changes. As a member of Church and Society Committee, I am committed to making folks aware of the injustices in our city, state, and country. I am also interested in hearing what you have to say about a wide range of topics. I would like to know what you care about. What concerns you about our society? What are you willing to do and to help right those injustices? For example, funding of public education, homelessness, mental health, affordable housing, children's health, immigration, women's reproductive rights, and there are others. Beginning in February, I'm going to have a series of small group discussions on topics of your choice. There will be differing opinions expressed. You can bet we are not all going to agree. And I think that is great. I think that is fine because It's just healthy to have people who have different options, different ways of looking at things. We don't want a yes group that is in its own little box that everybody thinks alike. We want to get along, but we don't have to all have the same opinion. And our goal is to have a better understanding of why people think about things in a certain way. I hope you will join in on those discussions. And then decide what you are able and willing to do to help bring about some changes. There's a difference between having an interest in something and having a passion about it. A passion means that you are willing to actually put in some time and energy into making those changes. We have to use our wisdom, based on our relationship with Jesus, to judge what is beneficial and acceptable for our lives and for those in our community. Peace to all who enter here. That is what our new peace poll says in four different languages. May it be so at St. Mark's and wherever you live and visit. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, help us to pause, stop, breathe, wait, and listen. May we hear you clearly in all that we do. May we come and see others different from us as your children and part of our larger family. Help us, Lord, to recognize injustices and work for true peace in our communities. Amen.
Spirit of God, let the world.
Thank you, choir. That was great. I bet you're all pepped up now, huh? So I'd like to introduce Joy Lee. She's part of the Church and Society Committee. I knew that. Joy came into my office several months ago and said, I want to talk about the Peace Pole. And I thought, well, it's been there for a while, so let's go look at it. And they have done wonderful things about it. We want to dedicate the Peace Pole today, and I invite you to go see it afterwards. If you don't know where it is, it's at the end of this sidewalk by the Fellowship Hall. And there's a picture. So see where the balloons are. I didn't know, thanks. I didn't know there were balloons today. So be sure you go by and see it sometime today. So we turn now to the dedication of our Peace Pole. Our first Peace Pole was given in honor and memory of our youth director at the time, Tom Green, 30 years ago. The original fell into disrepair, and we, mostly Julie, thought that it was important to replace and rededicate it.
Our Peace Pole is one of more than 200,000 in 180 countries around the world. This symbol of peace began in Japan after World War II. The four languages chosen for our new pole represent the community of Tucson. They are Spanish, Chinese, Tohono O'odham, and English.
Join me in our responsive reading as we celebrate our community. So when you hear, I am part of our beloved community, your response, which will be on the screen, is peace to all who enter here. Hable español. I go to Estes Elementary. I go to Nash Elementary. We speak Spanish at home. I play in a mariachi band all around Tucson. I am the mayor and speak Spanish at public events. I worship in Spanish at St. Augustine Cathedral. I am your brother. I am your sister. I am part of our beloved community.
Peace to all who enter here.
I speak an Asian language. I play Mahjong at the Chinese Cultural Center. I find solace at the Yume Japanese Gardens. I shop at Lili's International Market. I worship in Korean at the First United Methodist Church. I am your brother. I am your sister. I am part of our beloved community.
Peace to all who enter here. I am a Native American. I teach O'odham language at the University of Arizona. I play a traditional wooden flute at the Pasawayaki Cultural Center. I cook native food at La Indita restaurant. I worship at San Javier del Blanc Mission. I am resolute in keeping our culture. I am your brother. I am your sister. I am part of our beloved community.
English is my only language. I move easily through our community. I am a refugee and just learning English at the Tucson Refugee Mission. It is hard. I'm an Arab American and worship at the Muslim Community Center in Tucson. I'm an African American and worship at Mount Calvary Missionary Baptist. I am Jewish and I worship at Congregation Beit Simcha. I worship St. Mark's United Methodist Church. I am your brother, and I am your sister. I am part of our beloved community.
Peace to all who enter here.
When we pass by our Peace Pole, may we be reminded to celebrate Tucson's diversity and to help Tucson become Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s vision of the beloved community.
Let us pray. Lord, we live in a world torn by war. We live in a country where gun violence has become commonplace. We long for the day that our world and our country are at peace. We know this is not easy. We know there is no peace without justice. And we are a long way from justice rolling down like water. Peace requires economic justice for the poor. Peace requires racial equity for our brown and black brothers and sisters. Peace requires environmental justice for all living things. Peace starts with treating our neighbors with dignity and respect, love and compassion. Peace starts with each of us. We pray for St. Mark's United Methodist Church. May all who enter here find inner peace and comfort and strength. May all who enter here find a place to worship and serve. May all who enter here find Christian fellowship and a sense of belonging. Lord, be with us in our journey for peace. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Fortunately, the choir already knows this, because I had to make this announcement at the first service. We lost one of our members, Bill, this morning. So you will hear me pray for his family. And I just want you to keep Lillian and her daughter in your prayers. So let us pray. God, we worship and praise you for all that you have done for us, and for the opportunities that perhaps haven't even been unveiled to us until recently, or are waiting for us to discover. We give thanks that we are capable of offering three platforms of worship, knowing that while we gather in this physical space, others gather at the sanctuary campus, and still others are worshiping remotely. Worship feeds our souls, God, and for all who gather to praise you, we are truly grateful. Lord, we acknowledge the work of the members of the Church and Society Committee. Whether or not we always agree, we thank you for bringing us to the table and for using Church and Society and other groups like the Missions Committee to remind us that all that we have is yours, and that all creatures and persons are part of your creation. May we focus on every encounter as an opportunity to see you through a different filter. Lord, as the psalmist said, you have searched us and you know us. For the times that we have looked down on those who are not exactly like us, we beg your forgiveness. Help us to remember that we are not better than, more entitled than, or more loved than others of your creation. Jesus offered us an opportunity to walk with him, not because we are better than others, but because we are brothers and sisters from the same God. Give us, we pray, forgive us. If we forgot that all that we have is yours, it is only through the efforts of all God's people, whether that be a smile or a distribution, that we be instruments of peace for your planet. Just as Nathaniel had no idea that he would be called Lord, you know what, that we have capabilities and purposes that we haven't even discovered yet. Help us to wake up every day waiting to see what you have in store for us, and then share our time and talents with all whom we meet. We ask for your blessings as we try to do our best to serve people and your creation. God, we pray for Bill's family. We pray for those who are in the hospital, who are recovering. God, again, we are grateful for the opportunity to gather in different arenas, but we appeal to you on behalf of those who are sick, injured, hospitalized, or too disengaged to be in community. Bless them and help them to feel the presence of the Holy Spirit beyond the confines of these walls. For all of the ways that you lead us and in all the ways that you bless us, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. In the United Methodist Church, we invite our church family to give to special offerings to support the work of Christ around our conference, nation, and world. Today is one of those days. As we observe Human Relations Day, I invite you to watch this video sharing one of the kinds of ministries this offering supports.
Amanda DiStefano knew her summer internship with the Global Ministries Community Developers Project in Chicago would help make a difference. This recent college graduate just didn't realize the difference would be with her.
Coming here has been kind of eye-opening to just actually really meet and kind of humanize the population that is experiencing homelessness right now. I mean, we've had people here that have bachelor's degrees in engineering, or there was a guy with a master's in business administration. So you don't have to be, you know, a drug addict, or you don't have to be a bad person to become homeless.
A powerful lesson for a young woman who grew up in an affluent area near Boston. This summer, Amanda is working as an intern through a program with the General Board of Global Ministries, which is supported by Human Relations Day offerings. Funds also support the Community Developers Program, which aims to promote advocacy and social and economic improvement in communities. She serves in an outreach ministry associated with Humboldt Park United Methodist Church that reaches people where they are. Most of the time, it's on the streets.
Logan Square is a largely Puerto Rican neighborhood, and now it is gentrifying. So they're going through this process of young, white, college-educated people are now moving to the area, and that's actually kind of starting to displace some of the Latino population.
As this Chicago neighborhood undergoes change, the Humboldt Park Social Services Center for Changing Lives is living up to its name.
We are not interested in being a band-aid and just treating the problem. We want to cure the problem and the cycle of homelessness. 485 people served this month. There's one thing we want to be able to have in our community is financial stability. And so we provide financial counseling, employment job readiness, employment placement, case managers that really do the one-on-one support, and they walk with their participants.
Finding a safe place for this mother of four was just one leg of a long journey.
Guys, have been a blessing. From the time I walked through the door, one of my goals was to definitely become self-sufficient again, to get my home. The other one was my education. The other one, I needed counseling. I needed some help to deal with and reason with some other issues. And another one, the big one, I'm dyslexic.
LaDonna is now a student at Northeastern Illinois University in Chicago. She's enrolled in a partnership program that's grooming her to become a teacher right in this community.
God opened doors for me in ways that I didn't see it coming.
As a summer intern, our foundation scripture has been Micah 6:8, which says, "And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God?" And I think that the Center for Changing Lives is doing that. I think social justice is exactly their work.
Today we respond to the invitation to participate in the Human Relations Day offering as we stand with other United Methodist churches to build the beloved community envisioned by the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. This denomination-wide special Sunday is designed to strengthen human relationships and community outreach. In a world that often feels uncertain, embracing God's love shifts our perspective. Supporting the Human Relations Day offering channels our resources into servant leadership, community building, and ministries that embody peace with justice. Please give generously to this special Sunday by writing a check to this church and designating Human Relations Day offering in the memo line. You can also use the special offering envelopes found in your pew back or donate online. Our ushers come to receive the gifts of your tithes and offerings as well as your attendance cards and your prayer cards. Let us pray. In the midst of chaos, help us to be still and listen to you through the beauty of relationships and the strength of community. As we pause to offer our gifts on this Human Relations Day, empower us to respond to your prophetic call with compassion and love. With grateful hearts, we present our offering, trusting that it will transform into your vision of unity and understanding throughout your beloved community. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
So Bill is part of the renovation team, and he is bringing some words for us.
Good morning. I am Bill Zermelin, as she said, and I'm a member of the renovation team. We've been working with the consultants, ministry architects, over the last year, and I have a short message, a short request that I would like to read to you now. Our work with ministry architects over the last year has brought us to this place today. We are ready to launch the Volunteer Accelerator. This is a 3-minute survey designed to help you identify new ways to serve in and throughout your church. This is our first year to launch this, so our goal is to have 100% participation. Please bring your smartphone or tablet to worship next week. After the service, we invite you to stay here or move to Fellowship Hall to take the survey. There will be volunteers who have already taken the survey to help you if you need. If you're like me, there will be paper copies available if you don't like to use the technology that will be available. Like Nathaniel and Philip, like Simon and Andrew, like James and John, we can hear the call of Christ to follow him in a specific way. The Volunteer Accelerator tool may help you find a new way to share in ministry at St. Mark's. Please plan to join in taking the survey next week. Thank you. And now let's stand and sing our final hymn.
Thank you.
Do not forget to go to the Hospitality Center where we have our multinational treats. They are really very good. I looked at them after the first service. And so now, may you go out to be a good neighbor, to meet a new friend and to learn something from that friend so that you can help move out in peace for yourself and for the community. Amen. Amen. And now let us sing Shalom, which is peace in Hebrew. Go in peace.